Hi, everybody. Catherine Gillies. I'm a freelance. I have a little heritage company called Ergadia Museums and Heritage. Today, when I spoke to Eve about wanting to do a talk today, I called it a pocket full of small stones, because I was expecting to be 5 minutes in the graveyard slot after lunch if I got anything at all. And then when she said it, I was going to have a more important place, I felt it ought to sound more gravitas. So community heritage, what do we know? But the pocket full of small stones is where it began. And Abbott House is where this idea came from. And I am going to talk for 15 minutes. And it's going to be a hodgepodge of where the idea for this project came from and exploring a bit of the background. And then actually the big ideas for the project, I want to come from you. I want to just do the bones. Pocket full of small stones, why? Abbott House was an extraordinarily difficult and seminal project. I don't know if you know it, it's in Dunfermline. It closed a couple of years ago, despite heroic efforts on the part of the team of 70 volunteers and about 2.5 staff to keep it going. 20 years in the community, 20 years in the making, and it could have had a sustainable future if the political will had been there around it in Fife. The political will wasn't. And it closed in very, very unpleasant circumstances and left a lot of us raging, and including Museums Gallery Scotland. And Hairs were fantastic, or were they still HS at the time, and all sorts of places. And Joanne Orr and I had conversations about this isn't right, but it's really difficult to get change going and affect policy and get strategy moving and bring things together if you don't actually have the data on the sector. And we talked about the audit that Scottish Museums Council, that gives you some idea of the date, did a long time ago about museums, looking at all the museums. And I'm just going to have a drink because I'm also going to get croaky. And basically, what happens is that all the big museum-y type heritage in Scotland went into this big audit. The big beasts were in there, the nationals, the university museums, the local authority museums, the emerging industrial museums, and the independent museums. And guess what? You put all these disparate size of stones into your pocket. When you've gone a mile and you put your hand in your pocket, what do you take out first? You get the big stones. And the big stones continued to sit there right at the top, and the small stones, which are the independent museums, floated around amongst the fluff at the bottom of the pocket and never really achieved a voice or anything out of that audit process. So I started wanting to do something with independent museums. Over the last 2 years, I'm talking to lots and lots of people, that's completely changed, and I don't talk about independent museums anymore. I talk about community heritage, because that is really what this is about. And that's why I'm here. So it's about understanding what community heritage is. And in order to do that, we need a project, because we don't actually know where it is or what it is at the moment. So I want to use the first part of this just to explore where we are at this stage. I went home and rewrote my talk last night because, sorry? Did you want to ask me something? No. I went home and rewrote the talk, partly actually because of the things that were said yesterday, because I felt that there was a different temperature here, which I loved. And so I made it a little bit more sassy. The world has undoubtedly changed. This is Bannockburn House, which is a project we've been working on for the last 14 months. From when the first moment that the house went on the market, the local community thought that they'd like to perhaps have an open weekend. Next week it goes into public ownership after a Scottish Land Fund successful bid, which we were helping with. We are completely in a different landscape when it comes to these kind of big assets, because David Mitchell, head of conservation at Hairs, said time was this building would have been taken immediately into state care. We can't do that anymore. And also, I think, you know, we're not going to do that anymore, is also the message. So what we now have is a community group that some of them knew each other, but they've never done anything like this before whatsoever, is now going to take on not just a local asset or a regional asset, it's an international asset. Look at that ceiling. There are two in existence in Scotland. The other one is looked after by the Queen. This one is being looked after by a group of ex-miners in Bannockburn. That is fabulous. That is challenging. The world is also changing because of Scotland's rural past, Scotland's urban past. Adopt a monument, dig it, all these things that, if you like, the top downs, the big beasts, have set going, and they've empowered communities to actually go and do things in their heritage. And so they're all out there saying, yeah, we can do this now, and hey, do you know what, we want to really do it, we want to have a voice when it comes to the your heritage, what's your heritage, we're going to tell you what we want to do. And so, you know, if undoubtedly the world has changed, communities have also changed. This is where they are now. It's over the last 20 years, maximum. It's more like over the last 10, and there have been some real bow wave projects. High Morlagan is one, which is why we keep hearing from High Morlagan, because it really was something that did something. It didn't quietly go and do one thing. It recognised how, in a community, you bounce heritage across the whole spectrum. Other places are now doing it. Communities no longer expect councils to do things for them. But also, the big beasts are changing. You notice everything else has changed, but the big beasts are changing. It's an ongoing process. And, you know, it's essential that, you know, the big beasts actually recognise that they have to change because of things like not being able to take over Bannockburn House. They actually need you and need communities as much as you now need the funding and the support and everything that happens in the opposite direction. Community heritage activity, oh by gum. These big projects also need that too, and the top-down folk also need that because they can't get funding without it. Funding follows activity, doesn't just follow serious heritage anymore. If you ain't got a really great activity plan, your heritage lottery fund is dead in the water. Communities are respected for energy and commitment. Yes, they are. But not always their knowledge and skills. And, you know, not always their ability to capture the place. And also, not always to own a working lifetime of experience. Many of these volunteers are young retired, or not even so young retired, and they have eons of transferable skills. So yeah, you know, we love your enthusiasm, your energy, but enthusiastic amateur can still sit hovering over a lot of things that communities do. And actually, training transforms someone who's got massive transferable skills. It slides them across, and they're not amateurs. You know, a lot of heritage, I'm sorry guys, it's common sense. And I'm museums, galleries trained, and yet, mostly common sense. Are they equal partners with the strategic, the big bodies? I don't think they're quite there yet, and they actually should be there. So, you know, there's no doubt that the big players depend on the communities, and let's face it, the other thing is, these communities are free labour. Everything's being hauled back, there's less money at the top, there's going to be less money for heritage. One of the reasons that volunteer groups and the community is needed to help look after heritage is that it just doesn't cost anything, unless you happen to be running three jobs and having to do it at night. So, why is it not all good? On the right-hand side of that slide is the current policy for arts, culture and heritage. And I look at it and it, just the titling and everything about it just makes my heart sing. There is a new policy in the making. So I went in there looking for heritage and I found historic environment. This was formed at the time that HES was in progress and coming, and it was the big new heritage body. It's all about built heritage and it's all about place. And then the mention of museums, it's all about stuff and palaces of stuff, museums. It's not about, you know, doing a heritage project, which is a theatre project, or producing local publications, talks, walks, trails, whatever it is. That's just not in there. You have to travel into the arts, which also, no, you look at that, you think, where am I going to go to find arts? It's not easy. Thankfully, it's changing. It's all too much of a narrow focus, and it just doesn't fit. Community heritage and the way communities do their heritage has blown this kind of policy out of the water. Communities in the last 5-10 years have developed an entirely new way of working, which is diverse in a way that this type of top-down policy just simply is left trailing in the wake of what's happening now. I also picked out these words about communities to be reached or engaged with, how they should be encouraged to participate, and how they need to be supported. And I would say to the top-downers who are developing policy, that's not the way to go. The communities are actually engaged in their heritage massively. Thousands, tens, hundreds of thousands of them. You put all of them together and they will outnumber people working in this profession by goodness knows how many to one. You don't need to get people to engage with heritage. You need to go to the communities and engage with how they're engaged with heritage and then take the lessons back, because they've got so much to teach those of us who work professionally. So I'm both. I'm actually working professionally within museums, but I spend my life and have only ever worked for community heritage. So there is still too much top-down, too many major players saying, yeah, you know, heritage is great. And it's the way the communities is great, doing it is great. And to a great extent, I don't think it's necessarily the top-down fault. It is still disparate. It's still communities that are not always in contact with each other or working together and getting a handle on how the community is dealing with the way they do heritage is actually still quite difficult. So at the community end, we are not necessarily doing it quite right either. So, sustainability has come up an awful lot, and this is actually a key question in the house. And I mean, you know, we're taking on assets, we're taking on management of heritage. The sustainability has got to be right up there in the first big five, as it were. Funding is something also that, you know, we've heard a lot about. Yes, some, you know, HLF or whatever, listen, there's funding at the head of the projects. But you know what? You talk to any community project and any community group, and they will tell you there is a great big black hole before you get your first funding check in. And that is just the ability to get on that ladder. If you've never done it before, in theory, you can go to all sorts of websites to tell you what to do. But if you haven't done it before, some of these websites don't help you because you're still not in the language. Museums Gallery Scotland did a good thing with accreditation. A few years ago, they recognised that a tiny museum needing to go for accreditation needed to get help to pay for how to go for accreditation before they could then get the grants. And they made a small grant available, which has made a massive difference. This is something that needs to happen with community heritage, so that when a community group says, we've got a church that we need to look after, they can actually pay someone to come and help 2 days, 3 days, just to get them going, get them moving. So it's a gap. Burnout, volunteer burnout, I don't need to say anything else, massive risk. And also this business of funding, we set you up, we wind you up, you set off and you go, and then they say, it stops, you're on your own, make it a business. Well, if heritage was a really sustainable business, then why do the national museums, the university museums, the local authority museums, and the whole of natural heritage depend on the steel-clad hawsers they have connecting them to funding centrally? Why is community heritage not actually regarded as a player for some core funding? Because, do you know what? It's estimated that around half of the heritage in Scotland's museums is looked after voluntarily by the community. Any big important buildings are likely to end up in community care. And communities have no steel-clad hawser. They're lucky if they have a piece of old elastic that's going to break at any minute. And that's reducing as everything's pulled back. And it relies on public subscription. That's the lottery. It's gambling. It's variable. It's not very good. And it relies on people's free time. I want to know if you regard that as responsible management of our heritage, because local heritage is not local heritage. Every object that went into the National Museum started as a piece of local heritage somewhere. being part of a national institution or listed A on somebody's list doesn't make you any more important or worthy of core funding than any other piece of heritage. It just means that you've ended up in the system. So, how are we going to do about this? Can we get our voices out there? No, we actually can't at the moment. I don't know if you remember that scene from Chicken Run where the farmer panicked and he said about the chickens, they're organised! Well, you know, we're not actually, we're still at the very beginning of the film in terms of Chicken Run. And the other analogy is where we are is with Wallace and Gromit, you remember, which is the dog Gromit. And he's in the railway track going along and he's frantically laying the track in the front of the wheels. These two analogies are right. Every community project is only as good as the next tiny bit of funding, the next bit of capacity, and at the same time, collectively, we're not organised, and we don't have this voice. So, you know, what are we going to do about it? The project that has been in my head for the last 2 years, and that I really wanted to bring to this conference to get to talk to you about, is that I think in the very first instance, and this is where we all started, we need information. We need to actually know what's happening in the heritage sector. Joanne Orr, head of NGS, told me that they're very good at recognising community heritage. They give more money to community heritage than anything else. They're a really good listening ear. But what Joanne says, they can't quantify it. They don't know who's doing what. They don't know what's out there. You know, it's just difficult that way. So we need to get information, we need to get data, we need to use what we learn to support the sector, but we also need to be able to feed that to the sector leaders and the big beasts, you know, the top down, so that they can work on our behalf at national level, because we can't walk into government in our disparate, you know, wherever we are, state. And we just need that body of evidence that was like the national audit of, gosh, whenever, the Scottish Museums Council days, that did actually make a difference and created the industrial museums as an entity which then became core funded. That came out of there. We were still fanning about as small stones at the bottom of the pocket with the fluff, and we came up with nothing. Well, do you know what? I don't think we need to do that anymore. And so who is we? We is, at the moment, a fantastic top-down group who have all engaged with this project so far. Museums Gallery Scotland, Historic Environment Scotland, Archaeology Scotland, oh golly, now I knew I was going to be defeated by this, AIM are in the wings, and who else have I got? There was one other. Eve, can you remember? Well, so, yes, of course, thank you. St Andrews University, that's why I couldn't, because St Andrews are actually at the top of this. So we can't go out and get funding to do this, because it will have to be a funded study, without an organisation that has charitable status that can actually be the guarantor and the body that can apply for the funding. So the Museums Galleries Research Institute at St Andrews University, who I approached first of all, so apologies St Andrews, you were too near the top for me to spot you up there. They are actually the overseers of this project, the head of the project, and then the working group that we've got at the moment consists of everybody else, and me at the moment representing the community heritage sector, because I'm not only a consultant, but I volunteer in various things as well, so I'm on both sides of the fence. But as far as I'm concerned, that group needs to have equal, at least, but I think equal is right, representation from the community heritage sector as well. We need the sector leaders, we need the people working in it, and gradually work on towards that. But do you know what? We're going to have to start absolutely at first principles. We don't even have a definition for community heritage, and I think, Loretta, it would be fair to say that at our first meeting we spent more time talking about what community heritage is than anything else. And, you know, there's a dig on Liz Moore, there's a heritage workshop based at Denali, the brand new Geary Heritage Centre in Inverurie on the top right, Campbelltown Picture House, you know, fantastic project, entirely community managed, a community-run exhibition at Denali, and then my personal favourite, bottom right, the Field of Blood in Isla, which, as you can see, has absolutely nothing in it, and that's the point. Ever since there was a fight and blood was spilled in that corner, ploughs have always broken. They've never been able to grow a blade of anything. To the local folk, that is heritage, and that's something that's really important, and it's a story. But can you list it? Can you pick it up and move it? Can you do it? No, it's just there. It's heritage. So, questions. You know, we don't know what the questions are going to be yet. These are the ones that fell out of the top of my head. All these ones. And I'm going to come back to that slide in a minute. But, you know, we need to quantify it. We need to know who's where. So, big data gathering exercise. And then, as I've said before, we don't know what would happen after that. These outcomes are to come, but effective networks, shared platforms, onward projects. This is my baby. If I could have my wish for Christmas, I would like us to have Community Heritage as a new national body alongside these other organisations. Thank you. And I don't want to do that grunt work, so we need a Community Heritage Development Officer to do it. Right, I'm going to just now, I'm going to write down. I want people to sort of be fairly shouty, so we've got 5 minutes. I mean, feedback. Do you think this is a good idea?
Yes.
Could I have a show of hands on a good idea? I think that looks fairly reasonably thorough. It's certainly over half, like two-thirds, I think, something like that. So what would you do? Where would you go with this next? How would you even recruit the community people? Because that's the other thing, you know, we've got to find the right people. How would you suggest we can go and find the right people? Feedback to me, what do you think? You have a range of lists, and I think this is one of there's a data sharing issue here. There isn't one, this is one of the things, there isn't one big database. This is one of the problems, that we've got some lists, but we can collate lists and see who's got what, because they're variable. Yes?
I think you've got to look at small levels, you've got to go on the regional level.
Yep. Yep.
Almost 50 museums. And the only reason we know that we looked at it
locally.
So we need to pull that in each of the regions
to
feed that up.
Yeah, and the Highland is very...
Can you repeat what you're saying so that other people...
Oh yes, so that saying that we have to look at it on a regional level, and the Highlands have 90 organisations, almost 50 museums, and the only reason they know that is because they've pulled it together. Highland Region is actually doing incredibly important work right now, and they are the very first to do a project that looks specifically at their independent museums and sustainability in the sector. So anything that we do from now, and Lorna Cruikshank is aware of this project, and she couldn't make the first meeting, but she's in the group. So thank you. Yeah. Yes.
Yes, I completely agree with everything you've said. It resonated completely all the way through. I can be thinking similar thoughts for quite a few years now. Only in terms of the fact that there's so much happening on the ground, and the people on the ground know what's happening, and it's just the structure of being able to influence that. And what we have to be careful of is whatever structure we set up, it is not a top-down structure, so even the structure being
yes,
function.
It's a real danger. It all of a sudden becomes a thing again. Yeah,
yes,
yeah, yeah.
You know, we did ask Eve, I think, for our talk, we wanted to say how many community heritage groups existed so that we could make a big point. And she's like, actually, we don't know. You know, so that data collection and that evidence base is really, really important in the regional level, bringing in the partners of the local authorities, you know, there's all that. And so it's basically some basic development work that needs to happen in collecting evidence, working out who the key people are, defining all that stuff that you described. And I would fully support, you know, for funding, if it needs even application, maybe it just needs some funding.
Will needs some will. The people who can fund this are all pretty not very far away. So, did everybody manage to hear that? It's basically pulling it together and, you know, getting the data in, doing supporting it. Chiara.
I have a question. For instance, we started from the past. We are actually working with a group that will never
No, that's it. That's the debate. That is the debate. And how do we...
I also want to reach out to people that don't necessarily want to give an heritage, do
Yeah.
Or they never thought about.
Yes. And maybe it doesn't need... You know, maybe this is the debate. You don't need to actually be a heritage group. You can just be interested. I like the way the Scottish Transport and Industry Collections and Knowledge Network, please change that name, stick. They have a really nice membership. I think it's free. You just sign up and you can be a train spotter, you can be somebody who likes welding, or you can actually be John Hume. And everybody's in there together. And I like that. You know, is as you say, why do you have to be a group? You can just be interested in heritage and you can be part of the community. But that's the debate. Where do we draw it? Yeah.
Because we have got a good community council as well, and I feel that maybe each, not just the regions, but even getting
even more local. Yeah.
That you have maybe a champion, a charity champion, or a heritage champion, but use
like
community
that.
Council as well.
Yeah.
Because they then can link to all the groups in the towns, and I agree with the lady here. Not everybody thinks of heritage.
Yeah, and that's right. Do we need to change the language entirely? I don't know.
So that was about using community councils. If you can, you just...
Yes, sorry, yes, community... I'm so busy writing, I'm not... Can you help with this? Yeah, right. Yeah, so... So, yes?
If you're trying to think of new ideas about how to do it, possibly one side of it is something like a standing convention for community groups, and that might be the body behind, but you would need to have it do it at times that people can actually attend, so look for weekends, not in working time, so that people can actually get, possibly consider help with travel funding.
Yeah. So how should we actually pull that together, though? I mean, would it be a good idea to plan to have a Saturday somewhere in the middle of Scotland, like Perth, where we try and get people together to even start the debate off? I mean, does that start to, again, we still haven't reached the people that we necessarily want to bring in. There's lots of chickens and eggs. If at some point later today, or if you come and find me or something, will we have an email list going out, Eve? Would people be able to find my email address, or would you be able to email everybody my email address?
Yes.
So that you can bombard me with ideas, that would be really, really good.
Okay, question over here.
Yes.
I'd like to make 2 points. Firstly, there's newly launched organisation with the wonderful title Institute of Heritage and Sustainable Human Development, which is known as Heritage, and that sounds to me as if there might be quite a good fit with the objectives of that organisation and what you're talking about achieving in terms of having a central coordinating body that can represent heritage groups. From my own experience with Langside Community Heritage, we achieved charity status 2 days ago, and that took 9 months. And they kept objecting to one of our objectives, which was to build a cohesive community. And Oscar were telling us that is not acceptable as a charitable objective.
What?
And I would suggest that Oscar want to change their criteria, because I think that's absolutely appalling.
I mean, I think that's right. I think policy change, not being unambitious or anything, but actually I'd like to see some policy change going on a variety of fronts. And I think, you know, yeah, Oscar, are you fit for purpose as well as various other things? Am I allowed one more, did you
one
say?
More.
One more. Anybody got one more? Any more for any more? Oh, sure. Okay, that's good. Right, okay. Fine.
Thank you.